First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
All right. Yeah, we're going to do it like this tonight. We have the legendary Professor Griff with us. And tonight's show is going to be dedicated to Brother Gil Noble and Baba Steve Coakley. Their recent has struck the conscious community kind of hard. So we definitely want to get into a little bit of what they have done. Brother Gil Noble, for those who don't know, he hosted a show for many, many, many years in which that he had the great African scholars on, such as Dr. John Henry Clark, Dr. Youssef Ben Yakinen, you know, Dr. Phil Valentine's, and many, many others. And, of course, if you don't know who Brother Steve Coakley is, he actually was one of my teachers, as well as also he heavily influenced Brother Professor Griff. You know, so we definitely get into that information. He was the first to expose the Boule, who are the advisors to the kings, and the kings being the Rockefellers, as well as also the Ford Foundation and many others, that top 13 Illuminati blood clan, as I refer to them as, Illuminati. They are also called the Sigma Pi Phi, or simply as I refer to them as the house niggas. We got Professor Griff on. Greetings, brother.
Greetings. How are you, good brother?
All right. We doing well tonight. We doing well.
All right. I want to say greetings to your listening audience, and I want to thank your mate, the sister there, for staying in touch with me to make sure I'm on point, because Lord knows I need it, man. I'm in the middle of two Public Enemy albums and in the middle of trying to get this this book out, The Acapella Revolution.
All right. What your book is going to detail?
Book is mainly going to detail aspects of the revolution, but dealing with it strictly from a lyrical content and putting lyrics out there and positive vibes and positive messages through the music in order to raise the consciousness level of the people, letting people know how it's done, how it was done, pardon me. Why it was done, where it was done, what was the motivation and the influences behind some of the lyrics that went out there. Not the lyrics of Public Enemy. I want to let people know that, because a lot of times when I talk about this, people think, okay, yeah, we already know Public Enemy's lyrics, you know, Farrakhan's a prophet, and I think you ought to listen to, and that kind of stuff. We already know those things. It's the things that that weren't said that I think people need to know. Some of those conversations that took place, some of those songs that didn't make either Public Enemy's album or my personal albums, you know. So the book is entitled The Acapella Revolution, or The Revolution in Acapella. And sometimes when you hear the lyrics without the music, it takes on a different meaning sometimes.
That's true. Definitely. Definitely. All right. Do you have any of the lyrics on mind in which that you that's in the book?
Oh, well, you know that, of course. Well, I think a lot of times, I'm glad that you asked that, because a lot of times people don't revere me, you know, as a lyricist or artist in that regard. Are you following me? Because they don't look at me as being, how should I put it? They would if they knew. Let me put it that way. So I'm not saying anything bad about the people and how they perceive Professor Griff.
Right.
I'm
well,
saying,
you took it to the wrong one, because I bought your last Asiatic CD.
Okay. Cool. All right. Cool. Well, then,
and I was pumping it in my very hard, because that was one thing, you know, and that's when people didn't realize, you know, you was with Uncle Luke at the time on his label, and I was like, oh man, okay, shoot, let me get this last Asiatic, because I know this is going to be tight, because I know Griff, he's going to go in deep. So I mean, I got it and I loved it, you know what I'm saying? I always wanted to tell you that, you know, so I get a chance now to do so. And you know, and that was me, you know what I'm saying, appreciating your work and definitely what you have done, you know, as far as getting information out there as being part of Public Enemy, as well as also you being a solo artist, which, like you said, people have a tendency of not knowing, you know what I'm saying? But I mean, you are, and so I definitely would like to hear some of the lyrics.
Okay. Just to give you an example, we put out an album called Beats and Places.
Right.
And on that album, there was a song entitled Air Conditioning. And a lot of times people don't understand that we always do songs that are conceptual songs. Much like when you're dealing with esoterics. For example, if you look at the title, it may not mean anything to you on the surface, but if you go behind it and understand and view it in a different way, outside of the box, it takes on a totally different meaning. We know and understand, as well as I'm sure you and the people in some small circles understand, that the airways are sacred. We could go without food, brother. We could go weeks without water, but we cannot survive without air, without oxygen, right or wrong?
That's true.
How have these people conditioned the airways? How have they conditioned our ears to listen to some of these vibrations coming through the radio stations that ultimately affect our energy centers, which is our chakras, our aura, and thus shaping our behavior patterns? So we call this particular song Air Conditioning. Now, I think we need to keep in mind, as I, you know, cite some of these lyrics, that we have to keep the entertainment value in it, because this is what I think KRS-One was as the teacher, KRS-One was most popular for, edutainment, educating the people using the music as the medium. So the song is Air Conditioning. It's on Public Enemy's Beats and Places. Now, this is some of the songs that, and some of the things that I've written that are out there, but I'm not revered for this kind of stuff. I'm not even noticed for it. Maybe a few white fans may come up and say, "Oh, I heard your song Air Conditioning." I'm like, "Oh, okay, thanks." But you don't, I don't get that from the black community at all. Probably you and two other people, Black Dot, probably somebody else. Anyway, it goes like this. In this day of pimps and plastic, fantastic crack addicts selling airtimes with gadgets, iPods and MP3s, mega storage DVD CDs for free. Now, can you reinforce the lie? Now, can you pimp my high? 6,666 watts of mega chemtrail antennas for sinners. Like liars in a gospel choir. Like Sly, I want to take you higher and higher. Your subject matter's about bullets and bitches. Bag boys bragging bits and stitches. You got a writer's block. tube socks with new walls rocked. This sounds like the last blast of the last past 16 songs. Bunch of empty right and wrongs. The same beat, it goes on and on and on and on and on. Kill the repetitive bullshit. No matter who spit this shit, any twisted nigga can do this. A tug of war for your consciousness. Program directors play your nonsense. This shit is like nonsense for nonsense. Old school we miss. We rock jewels and we did this shit. Stop it. You selling sex for profit. Fuck saving a soul like McDevils is 2 billion old. This shit is old. Listen up to the situation I'm hearing. The heat is on. It's like air conditioning.
Oh, yeah. Now, if they didn't know you was a lyricist, they do know now.
Oh, get back. But I'm going to piece that song apart and go into it. And the very same thing.
Wait, you're going to take that and go into more detail and go deeper.
Right, exactly. And I'm going to explain it. But listen, I'm not going to explain it. I'm going to have the information explain what I said, not me.
Right, right.
See, if you look into the song and you may hear some things, you're like, okay, well, what does that mean?
Right.
I'm gonna have the average 15-year-old say, okay, well, you can go on the internet and figure some of these things out. So let me give you a link to where this information is. Now let's go study. Let's go. So it's no excuse, because I don't want to appear to come off like this extravagant, kind of deep-rooted kind of writer. I hear cats what they're saying, but a lot of times we need to stop, press the pause button, and we need to explain them things. For example, I would love to sit down next to Nas and have Nas explain some of the lyrics that he's put out without the music.
Right.
Wouldn't you get a deeper meaning what Nas is about if that happened?
That's true.
How about KRS-One? How about sitting across the table from Chuck and saying, what did you really truly mean? You understand what I'm saying? When you spit some of these lyrics and some of these songs, man, that people kind of grew up to, and it moved people to do certain things. What did you really, really mean? What book was you reading? What was you studying?
True indeed.
That's what I plan on doing in the acapella revolution.
Okay. Well, I can't wait. You know, when it's supposed to be released? When you trying to bring it out?
Well, I have to turn the manuscript in June 1st, so the sister's like on me.
All right, so sometime this year then.
Oh, of course, definitely. I'm hoping by my born day, which is August 1st, I'm going to have the book in my hand.
That's right. That's that Leo energy. Got to have it. That's royalty.
That's that lion, man. That's that warrior spirit. Yeah, so you know.
Fire, and that's what you hear in those lyrics, you know, is fire.
Oh, give thanks.
You know, it's fire, no doubt about it. We definitely want to get into, you know, the deaths or the recent deaths or the recent transforming or passing of
right.
Two of our great scholars and educators, you know, Brother Gil Noble as well as also Baba Steve Coakley. What you have to say about Brother Gil Noble and his influence upon you and, you know, possibly even your lyrics, you know, in which that, you know, that you have just dropped or maybe over the years, the influences in which that have come about?
Well, you know something, I'm old enough to know and I'm old enough to say, and I'm honored to say that I knew Gil Noble, sat across the table from him on television on a show called Like It Is. Myself, Sister Soldier brought me up there, introduced me to him. Beautiful, beautiful brother. And the story that I've always heard about Gil Noble was one of them kind of brothers, man. And Gil Noble was smart. He was intelligent. He understood how to work his way through this particular wicked civilization to make money and to live comfortable. Gil Noble was not conscious at a certain period of time. It was Gil Noble's show and him bringing on the Dr. Clarks, the Dr. Benz, and the great scholars. That's how Gil Noble became conscious. I don't think a lot of people know that.
Interesting.
So he wasn't one of these conscious brothers like we thought. He was always in the movement. He wasn't. He was not in the movement like that. Later on, he became conscious, because how you gonna sit across from Steve Coakley, or how you gonna sit across from a Dr. Ben or Ivan Van Sertima or Noka Rashidi and these people and you it don't affect you.
That's true.
There's no possible way that you can sit in front of these men, Shashi McIntyre, Dr. Francis Creswell Singh, and how are you going to sit across from these people and it don't affect you to the point where it changed your life? And that's exactly what happened to Gil Noble. It changed his life. And we knew Gil Noble as a very warm brother, very conscious brother, very inviting, warm-spirited brother. And so by the time I sat across from Gil Noble when I got ousted out of Public Enemy, he made me feel right at home, and he gave me the platform to, you know, to tell my story. But I think at that time I was caught up in the whole spirit of having to defend myself. And even at that time, ironically enough, at that time, that's when Steve Coakley came to my aid. So I was conversating with these two brothers at the same time.
Beautiful, beautiful.
And then the Steve Coakley, you know, I ran with Steve Coakley.
Right.
My whole mainframe, my whole reference point with dealing with the Illuminati and dealing with the New World Order came from Steve Coakley. I always mention Steve Coakley in my lectures. On page 142 and 143 of my book, The Psychological Covert War on Hip-Hop, The Illuminati's Takeover of Hip-Hop, I mentioned Steve Coakley on both pages with an actual picture of the brother so the people can see the brother's essence.
Right. Well,
but the brother did a work that's unsurpassed, man. I mean, the work that the brother did.
No doubt about it. Now, before we go further into Brother Steve Coakley, tell the audience, you know, the two books, the book that you have coming out and the book that you already have out, and where they can get the books from.
Well, my books that I have out now, one is called Analytics, and you can get that online. If you just want to go to PayPal, you can go to just use the 7th octave, the number 7, THOCTAVE, at gmail.com. You can get that on PayPal. And my other book is The Psychological Covert War on Hip-Hop. And if you want to order that, just use PCWHipHop@gmail.com. Or just call me directly, 678-557-2919. That's 678-557-2919. Or just go to my website and order from the website, www.pgriff.info. That's www.pgriff.info.
All right. Now,
the book that's coming out, I'm setting up a separate situation for that. And the reason why I have to do this, and I know it sounds kind of complicated, but the online proceeds from my psychological covert war on hip-hop go directly to my children. In case something happened to me or whatever, I have nothing to do with that. All of that money goes to them, my two little ones. I got a 13-year-old and a 15-year-old. Two beautiful young women I'm raising from girlhood to womanhood with the help of their mom. You understand what I'm saying? So that goes directly to them for whatever they need, on top of whatever else I do. You understand what I'm saying? Because sometimes we look at it like, even though you're not with the mom, I'm only giving them X amount of dollars and whatever. And sometimes ignorant brothers use that financial and economic thing as control over the woman and the children. And that's just not that's something that we should not be doing. You understand what I'm saying?
No doubt.
So that money, I don't even see, plain and simple. And I think this is something that a lot of brothers should implement. You understand what I'm saying? Because you want the woman that have your children, man, to be free. You don't want that stress on her because she has to educate your babies.
No doubt.
And this is what I'm trying to create. And I know some people say, okay, Griff, you're 50. You just now started doing this? Well, hell, I just now wrote a couple of books. So it's never too late, though, brothers. That's the point I'm trying to make here.
Exactly.
It's never too late. I mean, she know that you messed up. Ain't no problem. Humble yourself. Go back and say, listen, let's work something out, love. This is what we can do. This is what I'm willing to do from this day forward. And then keep your word.
That's true. Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. Man. All right. Let me think about the fact. First time I met Brother Gil Noble was actually on 125th Street in Harlem, actually in front of Sarnetta's table.
About, you know how many people I met in front of Sarnetta's table, but go ahead.
Four, maybe 5 years ago. And he actually bought one of my DVDs. So I was like, ooh, okay, man, all right. So you know, I got a chance to shake his hand and just do a little, you know, talking with him, you know. So that was my first time and actually my last time ever meeting Brother Gil Noble, you know, was actually assigned at his table. Now, Brother,
right.
Me, on the other hand, I've been following him for the last 20 years, you know.
Okay.
Seeing him between New York to Atlanta to North Carolina, you know, for the, over the last 20 years, and just going to lecture after lecture whenever he pops up in town somewhere or around us, you know, in the surrounding area. You know, matter of fact, I talked to him 3 weeks ago, you know, and actually, you know, sent him some finances, you know, because I knew, you know, what was going on with him. And, you know, the thing was is that, you know, he told me that he was doing, you know. I asked him, well, how are you doing? He said he was doing, you know, and I said, well, you know, you know, well, what else is going on with you? You know, I need, you know, some information before I can send you some, you know, something to help. And he was like, well, you know, brother, he said they tried to get me. You know, he was talking about when he was in the hospital, you know, you know, the last times when, you know, they were showing, you know, I think it was the last time actually when he was in the hospital. You know, he was saying that, you know, brother, they tried to get me, you know, and, you know, I just let him talk, you know, in order to, you know, get, you know, the information or whatever was on, you know, on his mind and on his chest out. And that's what he was telling me. And, you know, I would just, you know, think to myself, you know, because I also deal with the healing, you know, Qigong and Reiki and pranic healing. So I was just sending, you know, some energy to him, like, you know, you know, be safe, Steve, you know, because, you know, I know that, you know, it's some turbulence times and, you know, there's a lot of things going on, you know, especially in this time and this period, you know. So, you know, it was just, you know, a real blessing for me to get a chance to, you know, talk to him, you know, prior to him making his transition. You know, it was an honor because we stayed on the phone for like about 2 hours.
Wow.
You know, and he was just building with me, just building and going on, you know, dropping information and knowledge.
Right.
He was telling me the shows that he was getting ready to go on, you know, and everything like that. So, you know, I really appreciate Steve and all the information which that you've given, you know, powerful information, particularly the ones on the assassinations of, you know, Harold Washington, who's the mayor of Chicago, you know, on Malcolm X, on Martin Luther King, you know, even on Dr. Khaled Muhammad. You know, it was a lot of pertinent information in which that anybody goes back and check that, you know, check those DVDs or YouTube clips or whatever out, you know, they would be fascinated by as much information that Steve correlates from the various articles and magazines and newspapers and, you know, books, you know, how he show them squealing on themselves. You know, that was one of the most phenomenal things about it, was how he was able to connect the squealers.
Right. I mean, I think Steve Coakley stands, you know, in a category by itself. That's the only brother I know can step off a plane with absolutely nothing, go to the store and buy 7 newspapers and do an 8-hour lecture. I swear. By the end of the day, man, you end up sitting with this brother for 5 hours, 3 hours in the lecture, and then you go to dinner with him. You end up getting on 3 in the morning, man, because that brother can put it down.
Yeah.
He showed you how to decode stuff. I mean, like no other brother ever did it, man. Steve Coakley is a serious researcher and a decoder, man, for real.
No doubt about it. You know, I know when I was living down there in Atlanta and I first came to one of your lectures, that was back in like around in 96, right around the time of the Olympics. And oh man, that was so many. Ooh, boy, that was some years ago. But I came to one of your lectures. I can't remember the bookstore that it was in. I think was that it was in right now. It was like a little nice small bookstore. And and I remember you mentioning Steve even at that time. You know,
right.
So you know, and you was dropping yourself on, you know, the subliminal messages and in advertisement. You know,
right.
Breaking down the double cross and Exxon and, you know, and all this other information. And I was like, okay, all right, you know, he, right. I know that he's following, you know, that same path, you know, and I know he was,
right.
You know, because he's dropping it, you know, similarly, you know, and, you know, there was only one other brother that I knew who was dropping it similar like that. And, you know, he did like one or two videotapes and DVDs, and that was Brother Corey Johnson.
Yeah, know, Corey Johnson, who sat up under Steve Coakley, right.
Right, who was living down in Atlanta at the time. And actually, he followed me back to North Carolina to Fayetteville, and he was working for the newspaper there, and then recently he just moved out to Sacramento. So me and Steve were talking about him and, you know, and just us, how we kept, you know, getting in contact with each other over the years. You know, no matter what, we always somehow stayed in contact or got together or end up in the same places, you know. So I just knew that it's something spiritual between, you know, actually all of us, because like I said, you know, I first, you know, seen you do the lecture in 96, you know. So, you know, most, you know, more props to you, you know, because for you keeping this thing going and getting the information out there to the people.
Oh, get that. I really appreciate that, man. But, you know, like I said, in every lecture, I give credit to where credit, so I'm not going to take the credit when you come to my lecture and you hear me giving people homework assignments. That's something Steve Coakley did. When you come to my lecture and you see me decoding certain things, that's something that Steve Coakley taught me how to do. Do you understand what I'm saying? And, you know, I can't take credit for that. When I knew nothing about symbolism, when I knew nothing about New World Order, when I knew nothing about these 13 bloodlines, these 13 families, and who the Rockefellers were, and the Rothschilds, and all these people that's running things, it was that this information was coming directly from his mouth to my ears, because I sat up under him and traveled with the brother. Not as extensively as I would like to have, but nonetheless, you know, that was my friend, and I sat up under him and learned these things, and that kind of stuff sticks with you. There's no way that you're gonna run with Steve Coakley and this stuff not stick with you. You can pick up the average paper and you can decode even when you don't want to. If you sit in front of the TV or go to the movies, you're gonna decode even if you don't want to, because this is just what you've been taught.
True.
All right.
Oh boy, no doubt, because Steve dropped so much information. Till I mean, I know one of the last time I seen him was probably at A&T in Greensboro, North Carolina, and man, that room was packed. I mean, packed. I didn't even know so many people in North Carolina knew about, you know, the Illuminati. You know, I was amazed, you know, that that the college campus had that, because I know, like, when, you know, I tried, you know, when I brought you down to FSU, you know, State University back in the days, you know, it wasn't a fantastic show. You know, we had probably about maybe 50 people or so, and, you know, and I was like, oh, come on, you know, but I know that it was being sabotaged, because I know that the flyers, when we went back and looked for the flyers, they was taken down. You know, so
yeah,
I knew that there was a lot of
something strange happened that day, if you remember.
I left to go get my stuff in order to go pick them up, and I come back, and y'all was telling me that the lights went out. You know, but when we was coming back down the street, the lights was out all on that whole side. You know, was out. You know, so there's a whole lot of strange stuff going on. You know, so.
Right.
Yeah, no doubt about it. You know, so that just goes to show, you know, how. Go ahead.
No, go on.
No, I'm just saying that just goes to show how, you know, these forces don't want this information out. But, I mean, we still prevailed. We still did it, you know, and, you know, I still appreciate you. And I think we still got that DVD. Brother did give me the DVD, you know, and I always wanted to get it to you. But I know that right afterwards, not too, you know, I think you had the fire, you know, and everything. And so we didn't never get a chance in order to get it to you. So, you know, we definitely still want to definitely get that to you, you know. And,
okay. Well, hopefully I'll be able to see face to face. You'll be able to pass that on to me.
Okay.
So what else is on the agenda?
Well, I mean, you know, whatever you want to talk about. I know you want to go into the current events. I know you want to get into the Trayvon Martin information and possibly some other, you know, entertainers or celebrity deaths in which that had definitely taken place here recently, such as Whitney Houston, and your thoughts on that.
Well, before Whitney Houston, I think we do have to acknowledge the fact that there's some people that have been that have passed on and transitioned recently. That I think if we don't at least lend a few minutes to get the people that's listening to understand and really truly not get it confused and twisted with what Professor Griff made mention to in reference to human and blood sacrifice. Some people, brothers and sisters, just die. Heart attack, stroke, whatever. But when you find a large majority of black people, especially in the entertainment arena, dying in close proximity and some similarities that connect the people, you have to take your mind out of the norm. You have to take your mind out of conspiracy theory. You have to sit your behind down and say, now, wait a minute. This sounds eerily familiar to how the last three people died. You understand what I'm saying? And then you have to calm your spirit down and call on whatever deity or ancestor you need to call on within inside you to give you some kind of insight on what's going on with our people. That is what I did. So when I put the information out there in reference to human blood sacrifice, I mentioned Shakir Stewart, who took on the VP role and then the president role, I believe, at Def Jam, pardon me, after Jay-Z. There were some strange circumstances surrounding the brother's death. I mentioned Pimp C. I mentioned Aaliyah. I mentioned Biggie. I mentioned Tupac. I mentioned Left Eye. And as I went on and on, people were saying, that brother is crazy. You mean to tell me so-and-so sacrificed so-and-so? So-and-so did the human blood sacrifice and sacrificed so-and-so. So-and-so sacrificed his mom. This one sacrificed his wife. And I'm like, come on, y'all. Let's not get crazy with it, but let's just think. If the Godfather of soul, can I just speak real frankly? Is that cool? Is that all right with you, brother?
Yeah, no doubt. Please do.
Oh, okay. I didn't know whether or not you had restrictions or whatever. So just, if I could just speak real bold and frankly,
if
the Godfather of soul, James Brown, is married to a white woman, and what James Brown gave to black people in reference to the whole idea of the soul, you and I know, studying ancient comedic sciences, understanding metaphysics, we understand what the soul is. We ain't got time to go into it now, but study what the soul is, brothers and sisters, and why James Brown's vibration and his music and his legacy is so important. So important that you do not die and leave that in the hands of your open enemy. I can say the same thing about Don Cornelius. How in the hell you going to have Soul Train to hit this trip in America for all of these years? All right, keeping black people in tune with what's going on across the country with black entertainers and artists and this kind of thing, and presenting and breaking some groups like Public Enemy, who was on Soul Train. How are you going to have that? Then you turn around and you marry a white woman once again, and you leave the legacy of the soul of black folks, Soul Train, in the hands of your open enemy. How in the hell can we have someone like Michael Jackson, as much as Michael Jackson gave us, all right, in the way of spirit, in the way of dance, and music, and tradition, and this kind of thing, regardless of what you thought of the brother, something that Michael Jackson said in one of his songs moved you almost to tears, put you behind on the dance floor. You had good times listening to Michael Jackson and the Jackson 5. You had sad times. Regardless of what it did for you, it raised our consciousness at least one iota. We have to give the brother that much credit. We may not understand some of the other things that he did, but how in the hell Michael Jackson is going to die? And then now when you look at who's handling the foundation, it fell back into the hands of his two white children who will benefit probably more than anybody and now being controlled by our open enemy. How in the hell? Do I need to go on, brother? You follow what I'm saying?
But please do. You don't have to, but please do.
How in the hell are we going to sit back and you call Professor Griff crazy, but when I point out the human blood sacrifice and we're talking about Vesta Williams? How in the hell can we sit back and listen to that beautiful sister and her beautiful voice, and she end up in the hotel dying of a drug overdose like Pimp C, and you don't think something is up? You don't think to go look into it to see what happened? Where's the independent investigation? So now, I'm just, Bill, how are we not going to listen to Dr. Sabi, Dr. Leola Africa, Queen Afua, Dr. Lalani, Dr. Whitaker, and a few other doctors I could mention dealing with holistic health? And then you turn around and we have somebody like Heavy D drop dead. Come on, man. Bernie Mac drop dead. Etta James drop dead. We don't know enough about health in 2012 to stay alive? Come on, man. Listen, my drunk-ass Uncle Leroy, who lives in St. Louis, he's been smoking and drinking ever since I've known him. And you mean to tell me he's still alive, but someone with $200 billion in the damn bank like Steve Jobs, you dying at 56, 57 years old? Something is going on. You understand what I'm saying?
No doubt about it.
Well, I'm saying to you, I'm saying all of this, that if it's dealing with the soul, then maybe we need to look into the soul. And then I'm saying all that to say this. What is it about the death of Whitney Houston that them people were partying right downstairs, man, and her body laid upstairs for 14 hours? I don't have time to go into the numerology, but her body laid there for 14 hours. They said they found her submerged under the water. So much so that the water was coming through the floor and spilling to the place downstairs. And then, I don't want to reveal this particular gentleman's name. I'm going to reveal it this Saturday in a lecture that I'm doing in Greensboro, North Carolina. But there was a gentleman that was there at the death of Michael Jackson, and this same gentleman, I'm going to reveal a picture of the gentleman. I'm going to tell you his name on Saturday, because I want to show the people who these people are, that we need to demystify these people. The same gentleman was at in the hotel where Whitney Houston died.
Mm.
So he was there at the Michael Jackson death. Now he's there at the Whitney Houston thing. We're doing research now to find out where else was this particular gentleman, and who is he? I have pictures of him, Michael Jackson, sitting with one of the prime ministers of Israel. And that's kind of deep for us to go into, because we're trying to figure out whether he's Mossad, MI5, MI6, KGB, or whatever, or CIA. This thing is a lot deeper than what people think it is, man.
No doubt about it.
And we need to understand that, you know, to that degree, and stop belittling it and stop writing it off as conspiracy theory. Because you have to look at it. Well, was this stuff done before? Was this kind of behavior during the turbulent 60s? Was this kind of stuff pulled off before, poisoning people and this kind of? Hell yeah, America has a history. Okay, since I'm the Minister of Information, let me computer. Minimize that little window right there and pull up a new window. Go to your search engine and pull up America's Greatest Hits. When you pull up America's Greatest Hits, there's a list that it'll give you. Now, this is by Kenny Anderson. It's in a book called Land of Hypocrisy. I had it in my book, the first draft of my book, The Psychological Covert War on Hip Hop, but I took it out of the book and I reduced it for copyright. I didn't want to get caught up in this copyright infringement thing. But it says the following is a partial list of atrocities, massacres, murders, and injuries in the recent history for which the United States government is held directly responsible. Before I read you some of these things on this list, on today's news, I'm sorry to get so passionate and so amped, man. The LA Times reported and showed you pictures of U.S. servicemen posing with dead bodies. When I first seen it, and the people were coming on, and then they had some guy from the military basically coming on and trying to do a cleanup job, trying to fix it. So come up with our servicemen, the good servicemen that are protecting our way of life in these foreign countries. This is not our policy. This is not the United States and the Marine Corps policy. We don't do things like that, and they'll be reprimanded, and yada, yada, yada. We will stop lying, cracker. This is what y'all always have done. Recently, there's pictures on the net with U.S. servicemen pissing and urinating on dead bodies. Recently, U.S. servicemen burned the Holy Quran. Recently, U.S. servicemen went in and killed an entire Afghan family. So don't tell me, cracker, that you just started doing this and this is an isolated incident. No, the hell it's not. You've always done this. I can even roll your mind back to a book called Without Sanctuary, where the same people took pictures next to hanging black dead bodies. Do you remember, good brother?
That's right. That's right.
After burning the bodies and cutting off their penises,
yeah,
taking them over souvenirs.
Right, if I ain't mistaken, even little George Bush was seen in one of the photos.
Thank you. So don't try to play it off like this is something that is an isolated incident and y'all don't do this. Y'all always have done this. So America's Greatest Hits. 3 million people, 3 million Vietnamese murdered over the course of 30 years of U.S. aggression in the Vietnam, Southeast Asia. Well over 300,000 Japanese were massacred when the U.S. raided Tokyo and dropped nuclear bombs on the urban civilian areas of Nagasaki and Hiroshima. 600,000 civilians were killed in Cambodia by U.S. bombing between 1969 and 1975. Brother, this list is extensive. Pages upon pages of covert operations of the United States government aggression in foreign lands. This war on terrorism thing is not new. 500 years of European behavior. Killing, maiming, raping, robbing, pillaging. Murderous mindset and spirit. I'm skipping now. 23,000 people were slaughtered in Taiwan by U.S.-backed, trained, equipped, and funded forces. Moving down to 700,000 Indonesians, mostly landless peasants, were murdered in 1965 when the United States armed and supported general there to murder and assassinate at will. It says 45,000 people were killed in South Lebanon since 1982 by Israel, always armed and supported by the United States government. Now let's bring it on home. The MOVE organization in Philadelphia bombed. I'm talking about not your firecracker bomb. I ain't talking about some C4 bombs. I'm talking about deadly and high explosives that they threw over the MOVE organization and dropped the bomb. Do you remember General Torrijos, who died in a plane crash, who was a general to Noriega? So when they went down into Panama to get Noriega, right?
Right.
They went into the black neighborhood, and they used these sophisticated weapons that heated the inside of black people's body and burn you from the inside, leaving the shell of your body intact. Stop that, man. When we watch the news, the Indians said it right. The Native American, pardon me, the Native Americans said it right. These bastards speak with forked tongues.
No doubt about it.
Because they know how to spin a story and get you to believe some madness, and you start feeling sorry not for the victim, but for the perpetrator. Talking about defending your way of life. How you gonna defend my way of life when you murdering people? But anyway, so when we talk about what's going on, when we bring it home, and then we look at the mindset of what happened with our good brother Trayvon Martin, if you keep it in historical context, it doesn't sound so far-fetched to him to profile Trayvon Martin, damn near track the brother while he's on the phone with the 911 operator. And against the instructions of the 911 operator, who knows best, you track the brother down and shoot him in cold blood, and then the system of racism, white supremacy does what it always does and don't even arrest him. There's a gentleman by the name of Will Smith. They call him the Fresh Prince. When that went down, he put out a tweet. Let me see if I can remember what it says. There was an incident that happened in L.A. Kim Kardashian, I believe, was coming into a restaurant. And there was this really jealous woman, jealous of Kim Kardashian. And the woman went in the restaurant and brought out a bowl full of flour and threw it on Kim Kardashian. They arrested that woman on the spot. This is what Will Smith said. But Zimmerman shoots Trayvon Martin, and you out, and they don't arrest you for 50 days? There's a problem with that. Racism, white supremacy is oiled, well-tuned, and moving forward. And then, like Neely Fuller said in his book, The Code, if you don't understand racism, white supremacy, anything that you think you understand will only confuse you. Dr. Francis Crest Wilson came behind him in the ISIS papers and laid it out and gave us a working fundamental definition of what racism, white supremacy is. And you'll hear it from our good brother Omar Abdullah Johnson. You hear it from Wally Mukay, Bomani Baruti. You hear it from Phil Valentine. You hear it from Robert Blair. You hear it from Booker T. Coleman. All of these brothers that's on the front line. You hear it from Arlene Bay and other brothers. But how many times are we going to just talk it, brother, and then not respond in the way that I know we need to respond? I'm just going to throw that out there and be like, there ain't nothing wrong with Zimmerman falling off the damn curb and hitting his head, right or wrong.
Right.
Ain't nobody got to say nothing.
Right.
Ain't nothing wrong with him bumping into a door at Walmart.
Right.
Or slipping on some orange juice or Kool-Aid in aisle 13 somewhere.
Right.
I wrote a letter to some brothers in prison in Florida. And I asked a few other people to write the people that they go visit and stay in contact with in Florida. I don't give a good goddamn, a rat's goddamn ass who hear this. I'm saying it. Professor Griff, call me on it. 678-557-2919. I wrote a letter to the brothers. I said, listen, man, that cracker cannot go to prison anywhere in Florida. Nowhere in Florida. If they find him guilty, they better ship that fucking cracker to butt scratch fucking New Zealand somewhere. You following me?
Yes.
He shouldn't be able to walk nowhere in peace. And until we do that, man, shit, man, may the earth reject my damn body.
It's not.
How else should we respond, man? Because if that was your son or my son, how else should we respond? I'm not going to no rallies, man.
Right.
Y'all that are listening to the sound of my voice, don't call me for no goddamn rally. We need to take care of the business that we know we need to take care of.
Well, I'm definitely not going to wear no Skittles box and make a 52% increased profit for Mars Incorporated, the candy company.
Exactly. Now, I'm not just using the showman sound off, bro, but I'm saying, man, I'm saying. So I talked to my two sons, who's 26 and 21, and I told them, listen, man, that couldn't be y'all laying in a morgue somewhere for 3 days, and your mom and dad don't know where the body is.
That's what Dick Gregory said. I said that's what Dick Gregory said. That's right.
Thank you. Dick Gregory said they took the organs.
That's right. They took the organs.
They took the organs of the brother, man. And we acting like that's cool. That's not cool. Mutilated the brother. Same thing they did to Sarah Bartman. So guess what? So now, the Swedish minister from Sweden.
That's right, have a cake.
Is presented with a cake of Sarah Bartman yelling and screaming as she's cutting the cake. Did you see that?
Yeah.
So we have to be wise, man, in how we deal with this thing, but we got to know and understand, man, who we dealing with, bruh.
No, you know, they done told us the devil. The Lord.
Listen, a lot of us are taking Elijah Muhammad's teaching, and we got a black African-American president. This is 2012, so we've come a long way. And when 9/11 happened, white people were friendly for about a month. I don't know. So we're living the American dream. Stop that, man. Stop that.
Hey, as Malcolm said, oh yeah, only thing integration has given you is the ability in order to sit on the same toilet as the white man.
Thank you. Listen, man, this lifestyle that they allow us and permit us, some of us, to live should not be the thing that lulls us asleep to the point where we start talking as if the new Black Panther Party is the culprit. The new Black Panther Party ain't the damn culprit. The new Black Panther Party was responding.
That's right.
So you got black people on Fox saying that what the new Black Panther Party did was against this terrorism act, the Patriot Act, and they should be rounded up and thrown in jail and in most cases executed. Don't do that. Don't do that. That's not wise for you to do. No one understand that the brothers and sisters in the new Black Panther Party have probably feeling a lot more sensitive than a lot of us.
Right.
And probably in some cases, they know how to respond in the way they know how to respond. We need an element like that in the black community.
That's right.
Because some of us haven't done anything.
Right.
You want to wear a goddamn hoodie because you got some damn white friends.
Right.
Anyway, we're going to turn the volume down.
No, we not.
I'm telling you, man.
No, we can't turn it. Because, this has to be talked about. And it has to be analyzed. And, people just have the tendency of looking at things one-sidedly, like what you were talking about. And when Hashim the Zinger came out and he put that bounty on that cracker's head, $10,000, you know, and they wanted to up the ante on it, you know, I ain't seen nothing wrong with that because that was the whole part of why the Black Panther Party was founded in the first place, was to protect the community. And then the new Black Panther Party up under Dr. Khaled Muhammad was about the same thing. So, I mean, this is what we're supposed to be doing anyway in order to help protect ourselves, you know, because if no one, as Malcolm said, if you're not going to protect them, you have to protect ourselves. And that's just plain and simple. And so they need to release Brother Hashim the Zinger if he's still in there. I don't know. You know, but I know the last time, last week, I know he still was. I don't know if he still is this week.
No. I understand. I'm not in that position to discuss rules, regulations, laws, and policy of the new Black Panther Party.
Right.
But me sitting back and watching what's going on, I'm noticing, man, there are different segments of our people, man. We got this bougie element, this boule-type bougie kind of element, that sit back and want to protect white people.
Yeah.
They think that the laws in America work for everyone. Stop that. The law is only as good as the goddamn law. And they don't enforce it when it comes to black people. So stop that. But I noticed, brother, now I'm not being disrespectful to anyone. Please don't take it that way, brothers and sisters. I'm not. But we got some people out there that only want to fucking pick berries and fucking leaves and make herbs and shit. Okay, good. Y'all go do that. But then you got some other ones that want to stay up all night and just study. And study for the sake of studying because you want to study. Good. Y'all go do that. But you got a warrior class, man. You understand what I'm saying?
No doubt.
That's really sensitive. It's not going to sit back and watch people get shot down like we damn dogs. So when the warriors stand up and speak up, only thing y'all need to do, man, is give me some herbs that's going to keep me healthy.
That's right.
Pass me some information and move the fuck out of my way. I'm going to tell you straight up. Plain and simple.
No doubt about it. Exactly. Exactly. That's what I said on my on Niggas Scared of Revolution. And should they be, is because I was talking about that same element, is that, yo, we got the warrior class, but, yo, these are components that, you know, you might need to know, you know, how to survive in, you know, if there's no grocery store, if there's no hospitals, you know, and so forth and so on. I mean, you know, you think that you can just go against a tank with a, you know, with a handgun, you know, nah, I mean, you got to come up with something more strategic, you know, than that. And, you know, we were talking about, you know, add in the element of the science of healing into that, you know what I'm saying? These are the things that we all need to know.
But you know something, brother? More so than that, I'm speaking about the mindset
right.
of those that know the warrior class out here. You understand what I'm saying? And in most cases, the warrior class, we're humble. We don't kick up no dust like that because we know why we're on the planet.
No doubt.
We know once we set it off, man, it's on. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
But I find a lot of people suppressing the warrior spirit.
No need to.
I've heard it recently, man. It's like, oh, you're inviting him to the campus, or you're inviting him? Are we talking about the same militant radical dude from Public Enemy? You're inviting him to come in? And say, oh. Well, let me tell you, well, I don't know, maybe kind of, and they start to figure out ways that they won't upset their slave master's children. So guess what? The white boy said, wait a minute, I'm a Public Enemy fan. You damn right we invite a white boy. The white boy said, we're going to invite him. Well, the black people are standing there looking stupid. White, young white people were raised on Public Enemy, man. They know who the hell I am. They ain't stupid.
And
I tell you, I say it in every lecture. Like Cat Williams said, man, everybody needs some good white friends. I got mine. I got mine. Y'all better go get yours. Shoot, I'm dead serious, man. Y'all can't get ammunition like these people can. They got some sophisticated stuff you might need to be introduced to. You better go ask your white friends.
Go to them damn knife shows if they don't know what the hell going on.
I'm not even going to go into it, Brother Aline. Y'all, they know the people that's listening to me right now, they know what I'm talking about.
Right.
Anyway, we gonna be all right. Don't worry about it. Yah Satiwa laid it out, bro. You understand what I'm saying? Steve Biko laid it out. Mau Mau laid it out.
No doubt.
They laid it out. We know exactly what we need to do, man. It's no mystery.
No, it's no mystery.
We gonna talk about the plan on Blog Talk Radio, but we know it needs to be done.
All right. And we back, and let's see if there's any questions. Let's see what's going on in the chat room. All right, someone got a question about what you think about this past week of Tupac's hologram.
Yeah, I was looking at that today, man. I had mentioned Project Bluebeam. I had mentioned it in my lecture, the four P's. Politicians, preachers, president, and the pulpit. And I showed a hologram of Prince Charles and how Prince Charles was going to speak to thousands and thousands of people. And technology and how they were going to do it. And then when they said, well, Griff, okay, so what does that mean? How are we supposed to deal with that, and what are we supposed to take away from it? I said, what if they told you that Jesus was coming back next Thursday at 4 o'clock? And then they showed you the hologram.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
That's right.
You know how many people would drop dead, lose their minds?
Oh, yeah.
There were people that dropped dead and died in the movie theater when Mel Gibson put out The Passion of Christ.
That's right.
So can you imagine if this happens?
Hmm.
So we have to be careful. You know, not only that, they're going to make something that's absolutely not real appear very real. And they're grooming the people now with these so-called reality shows. Because we're looking at this as though it's reality. So we have to understand it's scripted reality.
All right, go into
Pardon me?
No, I was just saying, go into Project Bluebeam, because some of the audience members might not know what Project Bluebeam is. I know the first time I heard about it was back in 91 out of reading Behold a Pale Horse by William Bill Cooper. And in his book, he spoke about the fact that if all else fails, in order to establish a new world order, what they would do is put forth a hologram of this fake Jesus or Messiah, you know.
Right.
What's your thoughts on that?
Well, no, that's it. And I think William Cooper explained, you know, that and a few other things. And, you know, they took William Cooper out of here.
That's right.
Right
after 9/11. Matter of fact, less than 2 months after 9/11, November 2001.
Right, exactly. And we have to look at this. We have to look at this and say to yourself, look, if they will take out William Cooper, who was the gentleman that uncovered the whole AIDS virus thing? Him and his brother. It'll come to me. I cannot pull it to mind. That's bad. It proved that AIDS was made in a chemical and biological warfare agent that was made in a laboratory.
Right. I know one is Jack Fielder, Dr. Jack Fielder, who was a chemist.
Jack Fielder, right. Not Fielder. It's a white guy.
Okay, a white guy.
It'll come to me in a minute. But just like him revealing certain things, they took him out of here.
Mm.
Gary Webb. Who
right.
uncovered the Iran-Contras, the scandal.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? In California, found dead at his typewriter. The microbiologist. I believe it was 22 at all, them.
Well, the serious count now is up to 75, brother.
Oh, I have some documents where I only got that 22 of them.
Yeah, it's up to over 75 now. Go to Stephen Quayle's website. Just put in Stephen Quayle. Q-U-A-Y-L-E, and he got a whole new list, and it's over 75.
Wow. Okay, I'm going to just put it in and just make a note of it. But so my thing is, my point is, they'll kill their own in a heartbeat.
No doubt about it.
They don't care about that. If you're not following the agenda, they won't put a bullet in you, man. Ask Reagan. Ask Kennedy boys. Do you understand what I'm saying? These people are not playing.
No doubt.
They're deadly and dead serious.
No doubt.
So if you're hearing us, if you're in the sound of our voices, put in Project Bluebeam. There's YouTube clips. There's information about Project Bluebeam. Time does not permit us to go over every single project that these people have out here that's been out here. And not only did William Cooper mention it, Jordan Maxwell mentioned it, and a few other people, Alex Jones mentioned it. There's a few other people that mentioned it. Phil Valentine mentioned, Bobby Hemmett mentioned it. So the information is out here. We just have to become avid readers once again and start writing things off as everything is a conspiracy theory. And a lot of times what black people do is, if we don't quote-unquote believe it, then we act like it's not true.
That's true. Griffin, so, you look at the chat room, the world rules just
the website, www.stevenquayle.com. That's where you can find that information at. We also have another question. They want to know where you're going to be at in Greensboro giving your lecture, because, matter of fact, I'm going to come and check you out, too. You say you're going to be there this weekend?
This weekend in Greensboro, yeah. Greensboro, North Carolina, yeah. This Saturday. I'll put the flyer up on my Facebook page. That's X-Minister, X-M-I-N-I-S-T-A, and then it's Prof. Griff. So the X-Minister Facebook page, I'll put it up.
Okay. All right. We had another question, too. They wanted to know, can you speak a little bit on Rex 84 or the King Alfred plan?
Oh, yes, definitely. See, that's one of those kind of things that Steve Coakley hit me to, and it's one of those things you just kind of, when you hear it, you kind of know because you've dealt with it, you argued about it, you sat in study groups with it, and it's just one of those kind of things. Well, just in a nutshell, I believe it was October 19, in 1969, an executive order, I think it was 11490. The executive order was authorized to counteract this so-called minority, which consists of blacks, Indians, Latinos, Puerto Ricans, and poor white people. In the case of the rise from under the so-called oppression, in case they rose up, these things were put. This executive order was put in place, and they said in the event of widespread, continuing, and coordinated racial disturbances in the United States, the King Alfred, named after King Alfred plan. There was a plan named after King Alfred, and Rex 84, which was the Rex meaning King, at the discretion of the president. It said that they would put an action in place immediately, almost automatically. It would go into effect. Only thing they would need is a signature by the present president of the United States. But in a nutshell, here is the timetable. It says today the ratio of minority member combat deaths in Vietnam's, where they are serving as advisors. Mind you, they only said that they were sending thousands of advisors. I believe it was 25,000 advisors to Vietnam to advise. But we know what that was. So let me find the timetable of the countdown that they said it would only take 8 hours to round up all of black people in the United States. Below is the timetable for the King Alfred plan as tentatively suggested by the JCS, who recommended that the operation be made over a period of 8 hours. Now, the JCS is the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Number one, local police and minority leaders in action to head off the emergency. So the local police now are going to galvanize. The ones that are off duty are really on duty, because you know police is never off duty. Number two, countdown to 8 hours begins at the moment the president determines the emergency to be real. Shortly after that, the national, coordinated, and long duration of 8 hours are in effect at that moment right there. County police will join the local police in the 7th hour. State police join county and local police in the 6th hour. Federal marshals join state, county, and local forces in the 5th hour. National Guards federalized, that's important, listen, National Guards who are federalized, held in readiness, that's going to happen in the 4th hour. They're going to start deputizing people. Regular armed forces alerted will take positions. Minority troops divided and detained. I'm going to say that again in English. Maybe y'all need to clear your ears out for a second. Turn the TV down, turn the radio off, get your girlfriend off the phone, and listen. Regular armed forces alerted to take up positions. Listen, minority troops are divided and detained, along with all white sympathizers under guard in the 3rd hour. White people that are listening to this, They're going to round your behind up too if you sympathize with black people. Minority troops in the armed forces are going to be divided up. Your weapons are going to be taken from you, and you're going to be detained in over the 60 concentration camps that they presently have open right here in the United States of America. And don't try to go on Google Earth and find them, because they already blocked them out. We checked. All minority leaders, national and local, detained in the second hour. President addresses the minority on radio, television, gives it 1 hour to end the emergency in the first hour, meaning he's going to go on BET, MTV, V103, and some of these other so-called black television and radio to try to appeal to black people. If that don't work, they're going to round us up. Now listen, this is the important part. Number 10, all units under regional commands into the emergency in the 0 hour. Guess who they're calling units? Black people. They don't even consider us human beings. They're going to round us up. All of the units will be rounded up. Notice, a lot of black people already live by railroad tracks. We already live in certain parts of town. They're going to quarantine us. And depend upon the number that you have on your driver's license, if you still have a driver's license, they're going to use that to quarantine you in a certain area code, then in a certain zip code. So we have to understand that's basically, in a nutshell, what the King Alpha plan was designed to do. It was designed to round us up in about 8 hours. Now, they broke it up into regions. Capital Region 6 is the Deep South. Northeast Region number 7 is the Deep South Region 2. Southeast Region is the Great Plains Rocky Mountain Region. The Great Lakes Region is the Southwest Region. The South Central Region is the West Coast Region. They're going to round up organizations, starting with the Black Muslims. Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, which is SNCC, SNCC. Congress of Racial Equality, the Uhuru Movement. Group on Advanced Leadership, Freedom Now Party, Black United Nationalists of America, the New Pan-African Movement, Southern Christian Leadership, SCLC, the National Urban League, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, Committee on Racial and Religious Progress. Now, these are the groups of old, but they're going to round up the new ones too, RPGs, New Black Panther Party, whatever y'all call yourselves. You understand what I'm saying? We need to read the Patriot Act and understand what the Patriot Act is talking about. But that's it to the caller or to the person that left that or in the chat room. That's just it in a nutshell. It's a lot longer than that, but that's just a brief synopsis of the King Alpha Plan Rex 84.
Oh, yeah. He also makes the point, too, that last year during Christmas time, the highest thing sold was guns. You know? That was the most bought item during Christmas of last year were guns. And we know that has increased since Obama has been in the administration. Let's go to the phone lines. We got area code 215. Area code 215, you're on the line.
Peace. How you doing, brother?
Peace. How are
peace,
you?
Peace. What's good?
Peace. I just want to thank you for all the work you do. I mean, I got put on the Public Enemy when I was 14 years old. So everything that y'all taught me through the music really got me here to where I am in this part of my life, and I just wanted to personally thank you and everything that y'all contribute to hip-hop music.
Oh, give thanks. I really appreciate you, brother. I'm going to be honest with you, man. I'm 51 years old now. I got two sons. I got 3 daughters and a granddaughter, man. It's like some of my children are even rediscovering who their dad is. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. And I've been following y'all since I was in eighth grade when y'all first came out. And I used to have dreams about being an S1W when I was a kid, man.
I hear you, man. I was putting them in some serious training back then, man.
Dude, I was doing my left rights too.
Oh, yeah. All right. All right, good brother. I really appreciate you, man.
Take care.
All right, brother.
All right.
We got area code 614. Area code 614. You're on the line.
Peace, brother Lean. Peace, Professor Griff.
Peace. What's good, man?
What's good is a brother you see up here in Ohio, bro. Islam, Mo.
Oh, how you feel, man?
I'm good, brother. I'm good. Man, it's some very serious things going on up here in Ohio, man. Man, it's all kinds of little drills. It's all kinds of little drills is going on, popping off, man, here and there. They've been lining up the police over bridges at certain times during the day, running fire trucks and ambulances up the highways and out of belts. Army trucks rolling through the streets at specific times during the day. Choppers flying over. Man, it's a lot going on out here.
Yeah, and well, you know that was part of the plan in which that Obama signed, which was the NDAA with that.
Yeah, that's what he just signed late last year, right?
Right, right. Griff, you want to say anything on that?
No, not really. I want to hear what the question that the brother had, because I think that's quite obvious. We know, because I told people from the time that he got into office what his plan was. We talked about AFRICOM and some other things that he was going to do. That fell right in line with what I've always said about Barack Obama. In my book, Analytics, I dedicated an entire chapter, one called The Obama Deception, and the 10th chapter of my book, The Psychological Covert War on Hip Hop, is dealing with Barack Obama. So, you know, I put it out there already. So, what it may say is, and with the lip service, you know, it's already out there, man.
Right, it's going down. So my biggest question is, bruh, with me being on the conscious level, dealing in the metaphysics as I am, and y'all to being the master teachers, putting out here for the masses, and it's only we're a small percentage of us that's into this. Man, what can we do for these zombies out here, man? It's like, man, they don't want nothing but the basketball wives and all this buffoonery, man, that they got us in, man. They got us so twisted, and it's so frustrating for brothers like such as myself that's coming into this, that's studying and listening to y'all brothers and learning and trying to get the word out, man. And it's like they throwing egg in your face left and right out here, man. Our people on the lower street level, bruh, they ain't trying to hear nothing we talking about.
Well, my thing is the good thing about this, no one's gonna be able to sit on the sideline with their hula hoops with their cheerleading skirts on. You follow me?
Yeah, I follow you.
The revolution, everyone's involved in the revolution. There's no sitting on the side because they're gonna come and get you regardless.
Without a doubt.
That's how we have to deal with it. And the only thing that we can do, girlfriends, wives, sisters, brothers, cousins, homies, only thing we can do is warn them, man. Pull their coat, drop something on them, and keep pushing, bro. Everybody ain't going to make it. I'm going to just tell you, Phil, I know that's harsh, but everybody ain't going to make it, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know how many people I've been trying to get to wake up all these years, man, and they, my own children, man. You understand
right.
What I'm saying? Like, Dad, I didn't even know. You understand what I'm saying? I see you every day, and I ain't realize, yada, 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 whoop, be whoop. And I'm like, all right. Every blade
right.
of grass is not going to grow at the same rate, man. You may wake up today. It may take some people years to wake up. But guess what? Some people may never wake up.
Right. Right.
Only thing we can do is throw them a life raft, man, and say, here you go. It's up to them to get in, man.
Most definitely. Definitely, bro. That's what it do.
There
That's
is,
what it is.
There's some people right now that refuse to put on a hoodie and send a damn note on Facebook or through their email because they kind of figure somebody might come after them. But they won't move until it's their son. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So my thing is this, and I've said this loud and clear, and I'm going to say it again on this radio program. You touch one, you touch all. I'm going to say it one more time, man. Touch one, you touch all. And if that is not the spirit of our people, then they're going to forever do what they did to Trayvon Martin.
Without a doubt.
Babe, I really appreciate you, good brother.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate both of y'all, man. I'm listening. I'm here. I'm learning. You know what I'm saying? Growing and building. No, we out here. That's all I've got to say.
No doubt, Og, no doubt. We appreciate you listening, too.
Most definitely. Always will, bruh.
All right. Appreciate you, Og.
Peace.
All right, yeah. Before we get to the next caller, there was something in which that was definitely put into the chat room that we need to talk about. It was about, I was listening to the WRPN News recently, which is World Press, as far as the newspaper is concerned. It was talking about the United States government, in particular, the Department of Homeland Security has purchased 450 million rounds of ammo, hollow point, bulletproof vests, you know. So I just wanted to add that in there, too. You know, why purchase 450 million rounds of ammo? Hollow point said that. You know, if, some say that it's just because they're going to practice, you know. We'll see what's going on. But we're going to get to this caller, area code 786. 786, you're on the line. Peace.
Peace, can you hear me?
Yes, we can, brother. How are you?
Everything good. Peace and honor to you, Brother Aleem, and to your distinguished guest, Professor Griff. Brother, what's your thoughts, the way we're looking at this thing, that this definitely was a good possibility of an attempt, a subtle attempt, to try to cause, as the people here in the Northern Hemisphere, the Northwest Hemisphere, Mexican, to possibly rise up and then do something foolish, which would be probably detrimental, but at least we would take a stand on causing a so-called race war behind this tragedy that our beloved brother Trayvon Martin suffered. And, you know, compounded with, like what you just mentioned about Rex 84, and also, too, with the schedule, Planet X that's on schedule to come through, you know, that's compounded. And what would be your contingency plan or idea or some suggestions and advice, brother, on that situation?
I really would love to get into that, but I can't give the plan on Blog Talk Radio. Beautiful question, man. I can't give the plan away, bro.
In general.
Yeah, right. Nah, I don't think so. Call me, bro. Yeah, call me. I can't answer that question. I really can't answer that question. I can't answer that question in general. I would say we need to get some push-ups, get your spirit right. You understand what I'm saying? Go to some preparedness meetings. Contact some of your good white friends. You understand what I'm saying? Hell, if you can't fill a backpack, I said this all last year, man. Everyone should have this thing I call the black pack. Get a duffel bag from there at Walmart and go to the preparedness meetings and fill that backpack up with everything that you're going to need to last for about 2 weeks. Be able to at least do lift as much weight as you need to be able to carry your own weight. Right?
Okay.
Come up with some kind of plan for your family. Contingency plan of your own, just your family. So we have to at least do some basic stuff. Be able to survive without food for at least 3 days. We can't do it. Some of us eat 3 meals a day and can't even miss a damn meal. Some of us walk up a flight of stairs and out of breath. Some of us still eating pig. So we have to at least be healthy. Healthy enough to be able to survive under what you know we're about to go through, man. You understand what I'm saying? It ain't hard to tell. We can look at recent history and see what some other people have been through. That's what's coming down the pipe. But that's about as general as I can speak, good brother. And it's this beautiful question. And the brother's absolutely on it, man. And it should be answered, not only by me, by some other people that are out there that are speaking. Matter of fact, good brother, everyone should be able to answer that question. Put it that way.
Okay, brother, what's that, not to be redundant, but what's your number again? We can get that number.
My phone number is 678-557-2919.
Okay.
My email address is ProfessorGriffPE@gmail.com. ProfessorGriffPE@gmail.com. I really appreciate you,
my
man.
We appreciate you, too, coming on and sharing that knowledge, wisdom, and understanding.
Give thanks.
Thanks, brother.
Okay. Peace out.
We need brothers. We need brothers like that, because quiet as it kept, brothers like that that really understand what needs to take place right about now.
No doubt about it.
All this talking tough on the internet, and we ain't got plan the first, man.
I agree.
Come on, man. If I'm 51 and I can lift my own body weight and I'm doing one-arm push-ups. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
Can go 2 or 3 days without food. You know, no first aid. It's just basic stuff that you need to know.
Right.
Come on, man. That's some basic stuff. Come on. Seriously.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, man. All black people, we should just have this boot camp we need to go through and learn to train ourselves. All organization. I don't care what you belong to.
I agree. I mean, each organization has a task force, you know, anyway, so we should be doing the same thing. This is what I said in one of my lectures, too, is that if we have enough, if we look at this holistically, you know, we have enough in order to actually to form fronts on each of the battlefronts in which Dr. Nellie Fuller and Francis Quest Wilson actually spoke about, whether it's religion, labor, war, economics, politics, you know, whatever the case may be, we have enough organizations in order to handle each of those. And if we come together and form a think tank amongst ourselves, you know, and do what we need to do, you know what I'm saying, we wouldn't be going through these situations that we're going through right now. Best believe that.
Right. Exactly. So listen, I got 15 more minutes, all
right? Right.
All right.
You got 804 on the line. You're on the line. Peace.
Peace, Brother Aleem and Brother Professor Griffin. I want to ask both of y'all. Have y'all heard about Geithner getting arrested and George Bush and Bill Gates?
Yeah,
Timothy Geithner.
I heard about
yes.
it. Yes. Right, I heard about it that they got arrested last month sometime. You know. But, you know, the only thing they ever do to Timothy Geithner is put his behind under house arrest, because he basically is like them having to atone for the crimes of Henry Paulson and John Snow, you know, who's the last Secretary of Treasurers, you know. And, you know, what was also reported on WRPN News is that 1900 bankers was also
killed,
you know, so... there's a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes too. I think it has something, you know, basically to do with the stimulus program and plan, and a lot of that misappropriation of funds and monies.
Right.
Yeah, but you got to understand some of that, brother. When they say arrest, when it comes to them, it don't mean the same arrest that they arrest you or me. You following me?
Yeah. Now, they are. You familiar with Benjamin Fullfoot?
Oh, yeah. Somebody just hit me to him like a couple of months ago.
Yeah, he been on a paper trail, and he been discovering a lot of stuff, exposing a lot of stuff now. It's been a lot of fighting and heavy infighting within the Pentagon. And
right.
This NDAA, right? They saying that it's not for the private citizens of the United States. It's for these people that was involved in this AIG bailout stuff, and that they targeting in the G5 nations. That's where they at. And there's been a whole lot of stuff. Brother Aleem, you can do a show on that. I would like for y'all to just, you know, go in on that and you know, decode everything, and you know.
Yeah, Do me a favor, good brother. Give the people his name again. It's Benjamin Fulford, right?
Right. And also,
you have it in front of you. Can you spell it so the people can Google his name so they can know exactly what you're talking about?
Okay. Well, you can pull him up on YouTube. It's Benjamin Fulford. Ford.
Right.
And it's this dude named Drake. He was a military boy, Vietnam veteran, and
right.
he was recruited into this program to look at this document where they was putting it together back in 1978. He was saying how they used to go and tweak it, go back to it, and you know, subtract and take from it, how to deal with these people when they, you know, ready to snatch them up.
Right.
They made a joke out of Geithner. They said, in most cases, we have to beat a guy to get information out of him. But in Geithner's case, we had to beat him to shut him up. And they said that George Bush told on Gates and everything. But this is a lot of infighting with them. You know, a lot of them jumping ship, like you said, 1900, done left. But this military dude, like I was saying, Drake, he's part of it. Where he was saying that these people, they not organized, you know, but it's a whole bunch of them. It's a whole bunch of them. And when they they get all on. So
it's very important that you mention that, because a lot of us automatically think that, you know, all white people are down with one particular plan.
Right.
And this is why Dr. Francis Cress Wilson's work is so important, because on a subconscious level, they want to survive genetically. And a lot of them have a lot of infighting going on, but they'll never let us know. You understand what I'm saying? Right. Until a brother like you call in and give us the information and where to go look for this stuff. We really appreciate you, good brother.
Now you can look up freedomreigns.com. Let me see. Freedomreigns.com. That's F. Let me see here. That's F. Our EEDOM, our EIGNS, and you can get with Mr. Drake recordings on that.
Right.
Take you a little further into it, you know.
Okay.
He's been giving interviews and everything.
All right.
So I thought I'd add on with that, you know.
Oh yeah.
All right. We really appreciate you, man.
All right. All right. Peace.
Peace out. All right,
peace.
All right, Ike, any closing words before you go here? Anything you want to build on?
Yeah, I just want to let the people on. Well, thank you, of course, and your mate. Really appreciate you having me on for these couple of hours. Let me just give the people my information, man, because there's a lot that, you know, I wanted to talk about, but I guess everything happens in divine order. We talked about what we needed to talk about. So my phone number is 678-557-2919. My email address is professorgriff@pe@gmail.com. My website is www.pgriff.info. And the titles of my books, Analytics, 20 Years of Interviews and Conversations with the Minister of Information, Public Enemy, Professor Griff, and my other book is The Psychological Covert War on Hip-Hop, The Illuminati's Takeover of Hip-Hop. Check out my Facebook page at Ex-Minister Prof. Griff. I'm going to post the flyer for the next few events that are coming up in Greensboro this Saturday. I'll be speaking. I'll be speaking at the Slave Theater next week, man, for Automatics, his wife. I'm going to be dealing with Illuminology, the whole idea of these culture bandits coming in. And we're going to expose the culture bandits, and we're going to actually redefine and take back some of these signs and sacred signs and symbols and press the cultural reset button to restore hip-hop to its black African cultural roots. So, yeah, man, those are some of the things, you know, that I'm doing. I'm in the middle of these two Public Enemy albums. I got to get ready to go to the studio in a minute, man. I really appreciate you. Once again, if you just want to go on PayPal to order my book, Analytics for the Seventh Octave, at gmail.com. That's number 7-T-H-O-C-T-A-V-E@gmail. If you want to order The Psychological Covert War on Hip-Hop Dealing with the Illuminati, go to PayPal and order it. It's pcwhiphop@gmail.com. Analytics is $20, and Psychological Covert War is $25. All right, you're doing it from PayPal. Really appreciate you, Brother Eileen. We got to hook up once again. I was just with Booker T. Coleman. Last time in Baltimore, I was with Umar Abdullah Johnson. In Atlanta, I was with Umar Abdullah Johnson. I did Kentucky with Black Dot. Hopefully, May, I'll be hooking up with Seti to do a lecture together in Atlanta. And I'm doing this on purpose to let all the conscious community know, man, we got to start locking and linking up. You understand what I'm saying? This petty bickering and arguing over Facebook and YouTube and all this kind of stuff has to cease, man. We need to start building character in one another, as you and I talked about, Aline.
I agree.
Start building character in one another. A conversation that I had with Professor James Smalls and a conversation that I had in Wally Mukeba Mani Baruti at the release of his book, The Iwa, which is warrior characters and warriors, man. Let's start building character. And it's cool that you know you got a whole lot. We got a whole lot of information, but if we don't have any character and we don't love our people, what good is it? You understand what I'm saying?
That's right.
So we have to start building character. Once again, man, I really appreciate you. And you know, as I always depart, man, I always say revolution is not an event. It's a process. But I want to lead this conversation in the good words of our good brother Don Cornelius. I think if I could get it right, man, he says, once, thanks for tuning in once again this week. And in parting, we always wish you love, peace, and soul. All right.
All right, appreciate you.
All right, peace.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt.
All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
Burn.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments.
Burn.
Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance.
Order.
System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics.
Radio.
Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.